Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. And at question number one, I call Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide further details of the process that it will follow to develop a just transition plan for the Mossmorran industrial site.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has committed to publishing a just transition plan for Mossmorran following the delivery of the Grangemouth just transition plan, and work will commence in early 2025. Lessons will be learned from the development of the just transition plan for Grangemouth, and I anticipate taking a sequential and measured approach. The plan is likely to include a data-driven baseline, an outline vision for 2045, a corresponding action plan and a monitoring framework, and I'm committed to ensuring that this work is a business credible while embedding the ambitions for both workers and the community, and I welcome early engagement with all stakeholder groups to ensure their voice is heard and the plan will be co-designed with them.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Minister for the detail of that answer? ExxonMobil and Shell run Mossmorran. There are around 250 workers working there, and many more are employed through short-term maintenance contracts. So any credible just transition plan for the site must be co-designed with the workers and the unions from the get-go to safeguard those livelihoods. Can the Minister outline, further to her answer, what engagement process the Government plans to follow to ensure the development of a worker-backed plan? And will she join me alongside site operators, workers and unions at the summit that I'm organising on this issue later this year?
Minister.
Well, just like the Grangemouth Just Transition Plan, unions and the voices of workers are going to be absolutely central to the development of the plan. When I visited ExxonMobil at Mossmorran that I actually approached them and said that I would like to work with them on a Just Transition Plan, and they were happy for that to happen. Obviously, the Grangemouth plan is probably more important to get that off the ground, given the situation there is at the Grangemouth complex. But that's going to be work that's going to be brought forward into how we approach the Mossmorran plan. Many of the same unions will be involved in that, and we'll be able to learn the lessons from the Grangemouth plan and adapt them in the Mossmorran plan.
Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In December, the Scottish Government, which the Greens were then part of, cut the Just Transition Fund. They now ask about a just transition for the Mossmorran industrial site. Now that the Bute House agreement has collapsed, can the Minister commit to restoring funding to the Just Transition Fund for the future?
Minister.
So the Just Transition Fund is for the North East and Moray. I'm actually looking at the Just Transition Fund with a view to how there might be other areas of Scotland that can benefit from it. It has not been cut. Is going to be, in its current form, is going to be the same as it was when it was announced. It's been going to be delivered over 10 years. So it's not true to say that it's been cut at all.
Question number two, Tim Eagle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it has held any discussions with stakeholders regarding the future of hyperbaric treatment services on the West Coast.
The Scottish Government is aware the contract for NHS hyperbaric medicine services in Oban ceased on the 31st of March, and the chamber has not been operational for NHS patients since January. Review of the facility is ongoing, and Scottish Government officials have been in contact with NHS National Services Scotland as Commissioner of these services and NHS Grampian, who provide and coordinate hyperbaric medical services in Scotland. We are being kept updated as review of the situation continues and have been assured risk is minimised and plans are in place for the timely transfer and treatment of patients.
Tim Eagle.
I met with residents and businesses in Oban earlier this week, and I heard worrying reports that some local businesses in the aquaculture sector are considering relocating nearer to sites that have an active NHS hyperbaric chamber. NHS Grampian confirmed to me in writing that its decision to renew the contract with Tritonia was not taken for financial reasons. Will the Cabinet Secretary please commit to engaging with NHS Grampian further with a view to reinstating this vital service and to protect the aquaculture sector in Oban and its surrounding communities?
Minister.
I recognise the description of the communities and businesses that Tim Eagle presents. As I said in my initial answer, there was a review of the service earlier last month, and I await the outcome of that, and we are engaging with NHS Grampian.
Thank you. Question number three, Patrick Harvey.
To ask the Scottish Government, in light of its recognition of a housing emergency, whether it will take steps to improve the application of Policy 16 of the Fourth National Planning Framework in relation to affordable housing.
Minister Ivan McKee.
Policy 16 of the National Planning Framework 4 focuses on quality, diversity and sustainability. It gives strong support for the delivery of the right homes in the right places, reflecting local needs and providing choice across tenures. NPF 4 has already strengthened the affordable housing policy from previous Scottish planning policy to require at least 25% of homes on a market site to be affordable, unless local evidence justifies higher or lower contributions. It is for decision makers to apply policy on a case-by-case basis in accordance with the development plan, unless material considerations indicate otherwise.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the Minister for the answer, and I don't think that the problem lies in the precise wording of the policy, but it's in its application. Glasgow City Council, for example, saying that it's approved 1,500 homes since the turn of the year. That could have meant hundreds more affordable homes if the policy had been applied. Just to give one example, the Scottish Ministers rejected the call from Green councillors to call in the Shawlands Arcade redevelopment, which just in that one development could have provided 125 affordable homes. What is the value of this policy if local councils are not being required to apply it and to ensure that private developers do include affordable housing as part of their developments?
Minister.
I'm sure Patrick Harvey understands, as he does, that it's up to the local development plan having a clear role in how this policy is taken forward, and for local planning authorities and local councillors to make decisions on that. You'll know that Glasgow is gathering evidence for their new local development plan. I'll also know that the Policy 16 allows where there is a lower contribution is justified in local circumstances, and one of those is the impact on viability amongst other criteria. And I don't want to talk specifically on the examples he's raised, but clearly in a case where viability is important, it's not a question of losing a number of affordable homes, it's a question of not having any homes potentially being built at all, which of course has an impact on the overall market. So of course all these factors are taken into account locally, as rightly they should be.
Brief supplementary, Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, President Orr. I hope you feel this is relevant because it's about affordable homes. I believe there are over 43,000 empty homes in Scotland at large. Possibly this is more for the Housing Minister. There are over 400 Midlothian and 1,000 in the Scottish border. So what levers are open to the Scottish Government to bring these homes into the market legally?
Minister.
Some of this does land in the Housing Minister's remit, as correctly identified, but some planning does have a role potentially to play here. Work has been taken forward to review compulsory purchase orders, and work has also been, consideration has also been given to the place that compulsory sales orders may have in helping to support a solution to the problem that has been identified, and updates on that work will be brought back to Parliament in due course.
Question number four, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what the longest projected wait is in years for a neurodevelopment assessment for a child currently on an NHS waiting list.
Minister Marie Todd.
Long waits for neurodevelopmental support are unacceptable. We don't, though, as I've explained before in the Chamber, currently collect waiting times for neurodevelopmental assessment. CAMS statistics capture children who meet the CAMS criteria. Children who require neurodevelopmental support are not reported in these statistics unless they have a comorbid mental health condition. Our focus is on improving support. Our neurodevelopmental specification places an expectation on NHS and children's services to work together to implement standards in line with GRFEC. Crucially, local authorities have a statutory duty to identify and to provide support for pupils with additional support needs, regardless of their diagnosis. We're working with NHS boards and local authorities to improve the support available and allocated £55.5 million to boards in 23-24 to improve mental health and neurodevelopmental services.
Edward Mountain.
Well, Presiding Officer, if that's an answer, I don't know what I am doing in this Parliament. Let me help the Cabinet, the Minister. There's 24,096 children on NDAS waiting lists. In fact, some people don't even have, some NHS and councils don't even have waiting lists. But Ayrshire and Arran are saying that it's going to take 19 years and 3 months to clear their NDAS waiting list. Now, in the Highlands, as I said, the council doesn't have a list. NHS Highland doesn't have a list. Will the government at least tell them to get a list drawn up so we know how many children actually need help?
Minister.
I can assure the member that we're working with all NHS boards, including NHS Highland, to improve neurodevelopmental support and pathways. And we're working with local authorities to ensure that support is there for children and young people, regardless of whether they have a diagnosis or not. As well as the investments to health boards, we've provided over £1 million in recent years to the Fund 5 neurodevelopmental tests of change, including one in Highland. They're focused on implementing the ND specification, including delivery of GERFIC and multi-agency working. And we will continue to support health boards and local authorities to work together in line with the specification to ensure that the support is there for children who need it.
Question number 5, Russell Finlay.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it has any plans to revise the terms of reference that is set for the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry.
Minister Natalie Dawn.
There are currently no plans to amend the remit of the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry. Questions about the scope of the inquiry in relation to non-residential settings has been raised previously, and ministers have made clear the need for the inquiry to focus on its current and wide-ranging terms of reference, centred on the abuse of children within institutions which had legal responsibility for the long-term care of children. Widening the remit of the inquiry to include abuse in non-residential settings would result in it taking much longer to respond to the survivors of abuse in care.
Russell Finlay.
Thank you. There are two classes of child abuse victims in Scotland, those who are heard by the inquiry and those who are not. Victims like Susie Henderson, whose childhood was destroyed by a legal establishment paedophile ring, and victims like Peter Haynes and Stuart McMillan, whose childhoods were destroyed by industrial-scale abuse in Scottish football. They and many others simply don't understand why the inquiry is closed to them. They've also been fed misinformation from this government. Last year, Nicola Sturgeon told me the inquiry's remit is a matter for the inquiry. This is not true. I've asked ministers to widen the inquiry's remit, but they continually refuse. So today, again, I urge the Minister to do the right thing by these victims, and will her government please think again?
Minister.
I want to make really clear that our sympathies are absolutely with all victims of historical abuse. However, as the member knows and as I've just reiterated, the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry was set up under the Inquiries Act 2005 to investigate the abuse of children in care in Scotland, following a call over many years from survivors of in-care abuse. Now, ministers have made clear the need for the inquiry to focus on its current and wide-ranging terms. While we, the Scottish Ministers, set the terms of reference for the inquiry, thereafter it has been the responsibility of Lady Smith, Chair of the Inquiry, to decide on what is considered as part of the inquiry. And we are fully committed to maintaining the inquiry's independence from the Government. In terms of investigation and prosecution of those guilty of abuse, this would remain a matter for Police Scotland and the courts.
Question number 6, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reported calls for a moratorium on the closure of publicly owned care homes.
Minister Marie Todd.
No one wants to see the closure of good quality care homes, and I understand the concern that this causes for residents and for their families. Regrettably, there will be situations where local authority run care homes close for various reasons. And although we have overall responsibility for health and social care policy in Scotland, the statutory responsibility for delivering these services are for integration authorities to make consultation with people who use those services and in full awareness of the impact on them. It wouldn't be appropriate for the Scottish Government to directly intervene in local decision making. No one wants to see, let me reiterate again, the closure of good quality care homes. I absolutely understand the concern that this is causing for residents and their families.
Ian Smith.
The Minister will know that a disproportionate number of care home closures in Scotland in recent years were publicly owned, and those in rural areas, at a time that we have a delayed discharge crisis. In Lanarkshire last year, 64 people died while stuck in hospital on delayed discharge. People in Clydesdale were promised a step-down facility. Instead, what they're getting is the closure of McClymont Care Home, which has space to provide that facility, but is being closed. Now, even at this stage, will the Minister step in and stop that closure? Because she has the power, because ultimately those partnerships are funded directly by the Government.
Minister.
The member will be aware that I have met with families who are impacted by this closure in that area. I have also met with the chief officer and discussed this particular closure with the local IJB. The decision to close the care homes in South Lanarkshire was taken by the IJB. If I were to override local decision making in what is a Labour-run council area, members would be very quick to criticise me for intervening in a matter of devolved competence. So let me be clear. We don't want to see the closure of good quality care homes and services. We understand the concern this causes for residents and their families. We are acutely aware of the pressures faced by social care sector as a whole at present, and we are very grateful for the efforts of the social care workforce who continue to support our communities. The statutory responsibility delivering commissioning.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you. A brief supplementary from Claire Hawley.
New data from the Home Office shows that health and care worker visas were 76% lower in January to April this year compared to last year. Does the Minister agree this will negatively impact the day-to-day operation of publicly owned care homes? And does she agree that the incoming UK Government should overturn these cruel immigration policies that harm our care sector?
On matters for which the Scottish Government has general responsibility and a concise response, please, Minister.
OK, let me say I absolutely agree with the point that Claire Hawley makes. The workforce in social care is under real pressure and has been supported by immigrants for many years in Scotland. We need to have a system of immigration which delivers a workforce to do really important work, vital work for our nation, looking after our loved ones. And we need a system that works in Scotland. The current system is absolutely broken and does not deliver to our needs in Scotland.
Question number 7, Pam Gossall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to prevent children and young people from overdosing on over-the-counter medication.
Mr Jenny Minto.
The Medicines, Healthcare and Products Regulatory Agency, in combination with retailers, limits the sale of paracetamol to a maximum of 2 packets of 16 tablets. The aim of these voluntary measures is to balance the need for people to access pain relief medicines against the dangers for vulnerable individuals to purchase on impulse excessive quantities of any single analgesic. A community pharmacy may sell larger packs under the supervision of a pharmacist. It is illegal to sell more than 100 tablets or capsules of either paracetamol or aspirin in any one retail transaction.
Also,
I thank the Minister for that answer. I recently received correspondence from the health professionals expressing concern over instances of young people overdosing on common painkillers such as paracetamol. They also expressed concern over the lack of data relating to this issue. When I wrote to the Minister, she responded that National Records of Scotland does not publish an age breakdown of this data. Therefore, I ask the Minister, what action is her Government taking to increase the availability of data relating to drug overdose and age?
Minister.
I thank Pam Gosol for her question and recognise the work that she's been doing, as she referenced in the fact that she has written to me. And she is correct. I responded by saying National Records of Scotland does not publish an age breakdown of this data. However, I'd be very happy to meet with the member to discuss this further, to understand the concerns that have been raised by her constituents.
Question number 8, Bob Dorris.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is investing in affordable homes within Glasgow, including within the Glasgow Maryhill and Springburn constituency, to help address housing need.
Site Response Minister Paul McLennan.
The Scottish Government has made £328 million funding available to Glasgow for investment in affordable housing over the first years of the current Parliament, with a further £78.6 million for 2024-25 has been allocated. From this funding, £26.8 million is planned for investment over the same period in the Maryhill and Springburn constituency area. This investment will provide an additional 455 homes for Maryhill and Springburn communities.
Doris.
I thank the Minister for that answer. NG Homes in my constituency are seeking to develop innovative ways to bring void properties back into use as affordable homes, including 25 void tenemental properties at Stonyhurst Street, Postle Park, a challenge over several years. Can I ask the Minister if they will meet with myself and NG Homes to discuss their ideas regarding innovation around void properties more generally, perhaps in Postle Park itself, to see both the challenges and opportunities presented at sites such as the Stonyhurst Street site?
Minister.
I'm aware that NG Homes have already engaged with Glasgow City Council, who manage the Affordable Housing Supply Programme in Glasgow through TMDF. Glasgow City Council have agreed to provide funding to undertake a feasibility study to consider options for redevelopment of the pre-1919 tenement building. This study is now underway, and Glasgow City Council will meet with NG Homes in completion of this to consider the next steps. I'm planning to meet with all of the RSLs operating in Glasgow over the summer, and we'd be happy to discuss them then.